I entered the profession against my will, and I said it is a parasitic profession and all that. But you know, the legend of the profession is something which is fascinating. You know, you hear of great trials, great cross-examination, great lawyers. You know, it's a dream. It's your dream to fight for liberty. It's such a fascinating, very romantic subject. But then I never thought that my boon will be granted with such plenty.
Welcome to the K.G. Kannabiran Lectures on Law, Justice and Human Rights. It is now a decade since Kannabiran passed on. He was a man, take him all in all. I shall not look upon his like again. That was Hamlet. Kannabiran was a self-taught and self-made man. In a profession where godfathers and family and class meant everything, he rose from humble beginnings to legendary heights through sheer dedication and hard work. A prolific reader, he devoured every piece of literature that came his way as he struggled through school, college, and practice. It was precisely that reading which expanded his mind. What forged him into a legend was a sensitive and brilliant defense of political dissidents and revolutionaries who were hunted down by the state during the emergency. He converted the courtroom into a literary convention, often asking his clients to recite poetry or explain the philosophy for which they were charged to the judge. He prided himself on his radical interpretation of the law, often educating the judges before whom he appeared to interpret the spirit and intent of the Constitution. He was admired and loved for his fearless defense of causes, coupled with a deep tenderness for his poorer clients, which made him a much loved figure in Andhra Pradesh. He inspired many young lawyers searching for some meaning and radical dimensions in the practice of law. As president of the Andhra Pradesh Civil Liberties Committee and the People's Union of Civil Liberties, he was critical to expanding these movements to powerful institutions of human rights defense. He was involved in human rights work across the country, which was idolized and adored, particularly in his home state, Andhra Pradesh, by the poor and disempowered and often resented by rich and powerful people unless they had a case or a cause they needed him to fight. It is now a decade since his death, and given the state of human rights today, his presence is sorely missed. This is an effort to preserve his heritage for the bright young lawyers who are emerging today, a generation that he sincerely believed would restore decency, dignity, and justice to our country. Thank you.
The family of K.G. Kannabiran welcomes you to the K.G. Kannabiran Lectures on Law, Justice, and Human Rights. 10 years after his death, we remember his spirit, his resistance, and his constitutional insurgencies in courts and through courts and tribunals, in defense of dissent, personal liberty, associational freedoms, and justice, speaking truth to power, calling for judicial accountability and state accountability, especially in the matter of repressive laws, custodial violence, and extrajudicial murders, encounter killings, calling out entrenched practices of discrimination and structural violence, and setting out the basic structures of constitutional rule. We bring together a few of the lawyers and judges who knew him personally and worked with him on cases, campaigns, and tribunals to remember their collaborations with him and reflect on future pathways of this important slice of the history of lawyering for human rights and civil liberties, rooted in the Indian experience. K.G. Kannabiran lived and worked in Andhra Pradesh, in Hyderabad. He traveled across the country, appearing in courts of trial and high courts and in people's tribunals and fact-finding missions. from Kashmir, Assam and Manipur to Tamil Nadu, Chhattisgarh to Gujarat to Punjab, Karnataka and beyond. Within Andhra, every nook and corner, every forest and town bear his footprints. Practically every court in every jurisdiction in the state bears his imprint. Every university, meeting hall, meeting ground has heard him speak untiringly on the meanings of the rule of law and the constitution. No place was out of bounds in his quest for justice. We hope to remember him through the futures of his work and through the work of those who carry it forward in so many different ways. In this specific segment of lectures, we bring together the voices of those who shared his calling. Justice B. Sudarshan Reddy, former judge of the Supreme Court of India, started his legal practice on civil and constitutional matters in Hyderabad. He was elected president of Andhra Pradesh High Court Advocates Association in 1993 and was elevated to the bench of the AP High Court the same year. He was appointed as Chief Justice of Guwahati High Court in December 2005 and as Judge of the Supreme Court of India in January 2007, retiring in July 2011. A member of the People's Union for Civil Liberties during its founding years in the late 1970s, Justice Sudarshan Reddy's judicial delineation of rights under the Constitution of India is memorable. His conviviality with bar and bench is widely recalled as setting him apart in an otherwise hierarchical environment. During his tenure in the Supreme Court, he brought the Constitution to bear on cases and matters that would normally not be decided within its writ, thus re-inscribing the canons of constitutional law in enduring ways. His articulation of the triadic ethical framework of the Constitution and the centrality of directive principles is unparalleled and particularly critical to the understanding of constitutionalism in the present time, beset as we are with a rapidly disappearing space for such sustained public deliberations. Justice B. Sudarshan Reddy delivers the first K.G. Kannabiran commemoration lecture on law, justice and human rights.
Let me unreservedly place and record that I feel it to be a great honor to have been asked to deliver this lecture in memory of Sri Kannabiran, a remarkable senior advocate who was an indefatigable warrior for justice, a scholarly expositor of law and the political economy, a human being endowed with an abundance of understanding of the human condition, and above all, an optimist with an indefeasible empathy for human potential. As members of the bar would be all too aware, the humility one ought to feel is also an indication that achievements in instantiating justice and democratic practices are not dependent on whether one holds high constitutional office or not. The potential for success of conjoined projects of democracy and justice is functionally more dependent on the efforts that members of the bar than what the constrained operational width of those serving on the bench allows. This is especially true when we deal with the stalwarts of the bar who have been devoted their entire life to the protection of civil liberties, like Sri Kannabiran did. His life and service to the bar and the temple of justice are too well known to reiterate here. It would suffice to say that especially when most reasonable people are beginning to air foundational questions about whether the institutions of justice are even attempting to serve the cause of justice, it is only apt that we gather to engage in some soul searching in memory of a remarkable human being who fought throughout his life for the cause of the weakest against what he perceived were instances of misuse of the institutions and of an ostensible constitutional democracy. I must of course place on record my personal debt of gratitude to Sri K.G. Kannabiran. By the time I began to practice law in full earnestness in the mid-1970s, he was already a star to whom neophytes could turn to for advice and guidance. As I do not recall Even a single instance where Sri Kanabiran did not extend the benefits to junior advocates of a very capacious and brilliant mind that he possessed. His role in founding the PUCL is well known, and I, as its member, almost from the days of its founding, immensely benefited from the sense of security, intellectual and moral, that it is provided. Younger and idealistic lawyers who believed that the foremost of the promises of a constitutional democracy are with regard to safeguarding civil liberties, especially of the weakest, while also promoting the state as a platform for collective action to quickly transform the Indian society from its moorings in graded hierarchies of different and discrimination. It was my honor to have assisted him in a number of cases, as indeed it was a humbling experience when I appeared against him. If the former occasions were didactic, the opportunities to go up against him were occasions of chastisement delivered with courtesy. In either case, he was a born teacher. I must also place on record the fact that after I was elevated to the bench, Sri Kanabiran appeared before me, and each of those occasions was a privilege, and his appearances are cherished. I would like to briefly talk about one case in which I worked closely with him. In the mid-1990s, the state of Andhra Pradesh had enacted a legislation that gave the state very sharp and deep tentacles of control over institutions of higher education. My inclination was to frame the arguments against that particular law on the basis of lack of legislative competence, essentially framing the issue in black letter law terms. As a senior advocate, Sri Kanabiran insisted that protection of the autonomy of institutions of higher education was not merely a matter of the positive law, but also one of the essential scaffolds of normative foundations of what the Indian Constitution sought to inscribe in our lives. He modulated the arguments of legislative competence through the sieve of essential autonomy for institutions of higher education as an aspect of free exploration of knowledge and human dignity. As he explained it then, constitutionalism in its essence is about constant reaffirmation of human dignity and a continuous reconstitution of the social between individuals, between groups, and those in turn with the state. Universities are spaces in which knowledge itself is constituted and reconstituted, both as a matter of learning, existing knowledge, and affirmation of the ever-present possibility of new knowledge, necessarily had to have a significant measure of autonomy, not merely as a matter of statutory concessions, but as an inherent feature of a constitutional order and cared about human dignity. And such memories of Sri K.G. Kanabiran must necessarily underscore the angst we must feel about the continued imprisonment of an elder wheelchair-bounded academic, suffering grave illness for the mere possession of certain texts and literature for deliberation in academic setting. And that angst assumes greater acuity as the reports filter in of the shooting dead of a teacher who was allegedly sharing images of a messenger of God for discussion in a classroom. The state and the society are always locked in a dialectic processes, and whether the institutions of both the civil society as well as the state consciously try to promote the core values of the Constitution and give expression to the moral urgency of the consequential changes needed to protect innate humanity of citizens and the groups they belong to has a crucial bearing on whether the Constitution continues to be worked or not. It just seems that we have fewer and fewer people willing to boldly work the constitution. If you detect the tone of wistfulness in my voice, it's of course for the man. For men such as K.G. Kanabiran were rare, even in his day and arguably much rarer today. But the tone is also for myself, beset by confusion about the particular denouement we find ourselves in, not just in India, but across the world. Buffeted for the past 4 or 5 decades by a framework of amorality, in which a greed was to be the sole good, the individual to be the sole endpoint of any decisional matrix, and the better off to be the first to be served. Justice, societies across the globe are now marked by record levels of inequality, primarily in the economic sphere, which in turn multiplies the impact of socio-cultural and political inequalities many four times. Increasing abandonment of the constitutional projects and emerging kernels of serious social unrest. For the good part of the last 2 decades, I have been expressing my unease at the arc of events globally and India in various public lectures. I believe that the unease now increasingly shaping into alarm, given the events across the world in general, more particularly in India, especially over the past few years. Much has been written about the failures of judiciary, as revealed more particularly by its obvious reluctance of a recent iteration and vintage to fully bear its burden of being a check on the inherent tendency of the executive to overreach and go beyond the limits of the law, and also abandon many of the core elements of the constitutional project. If there was one tenet that seemed beyond the pale of doubt, as far as the constitutional projects that emerged in the first flush of hope after World War II are concerned, it was that democracy necessarily has to be accompanied by a constitutional restraint, guarded and articulated by the judiciary on the context in which the executive exercises force, the modes of exhibition of that force, including but not limited to adherence to the principle that the state should have an exclusive monopoly to eliminate the violence by social groups, and the extents of its use. For a brief but horrifying period in the mid-70s, we confronted the possibilities of, and to a large extent instantiated in reality, the prospects that a democracy modulated by a constitutional restraint was but a brief flash of hope that was to disappear, as it was to with many other colonial societies. And the nation states, as images emerged again and again in some newspapers and in a few other forms of media, the mobs of private individuals and the social groups, attacking and targeting specific localities and particular segments of the populace, the reluctance of constitutional courts to exert or even seriously attempt articulation of any tenets of constitutional morality as guides for the lawmakers. The lawkeepers and the subjects of law was marked as visuals emerged that the lawbreakers were ostensibly acting with impunity under the active protection of the police. It seemed that the reluctance might actually be a case of abdication, and many reasonable people might even believe that they have valid grounds for opining that it was deliberate. Many of the fears of the mid-70s have returned to write, increasingly deeper lines of worry. One of the essentials of determining whether the law is prima facie valid are questions about which forum enacted the law and whether it was done in a manner that warrants legitimacy. This is, of course, in addition to the constitutional norm that law cannot violate Part 3 of the Constitution. For long, many scholars have been talking about how imperial executives have used legislatures or mere rubber stamps. However, over the past 2 decades, what has become even more likely, and sadly also in jurisdictions that claim pride in being properly functioning constitutional democracies, is that the enactment of law and framing of policy takes place without much debate. The absence of being much more marked in the ruling cliques. The absence of debate underscores the overarching themes of neoliberalism, that much of the economy, or almost all of it, and maybe even life, including social life, are beyond the pale of law. This necessarily has a chilling effect on the importance of legislatures as bodies of public deliberation, and indeed of public welfare and a common good. Policy which can be carried through into effect only by the sanction of the law becomes the exclusive prerogative of the dealings between the executive and the elites, especially the monstrous power wielders. The oligopolies and a handful of autocrats and the legislatures are relegated to being perfunctory rubber stamps. The underlying logic and the forces that it unleashes, as well as is underscored by, means that the relationships between the legislatures and the imperial executives across the world are now marked by suicidal partisanship and subservience. From a public law perspective, the twinning of the fates of legislatures to their efficacy of serving as fora for extolling the alleged virtues of the imperial executives, manufactured by a fawning media, financed and controlled by the big business, also implies that legislators are less lawmakers, but more akin to cheerleaders. One tip of the leading edge of the stormtroopers to attack any attempt at the critiquing of law and the policy instantiated at the behest of the imperial executive. Not just that, even the critiquing the performance, whether it be inside the legislative halls or outside in public of the executive in implementing the law, is increasingly being treated as anti-national and are treasonous. This slippery side has led us into a morass where we seemingly do not even have to bother to count the votes in the legislative halls, not even when majorities are razor thin. The speakers of the legislatures, who are for long now have been partisan party members, seemingly are now willing orchestrators of painting a thin veneer of institutional acceptance of the desires and commands of the imperial executive. Once we accept the overriding assumption that the political processes have nothing to do or to say about the public welfare, common good, and the cherished national goals, then the question of whether there is an actual majority or not becomes irrelevant. The processes of debating proposed laws, of voting on them in legislatures, and accounting of those votes by people's representatives, no longer a necessary indicator of legality. At best, they have begun to resemble a formality that is also now likely to be dispensed with. And even that is likely to be picked off soon enough. We, after all, have recently been witness to repeated claims of one of the more powerful protagonists of the imperial executives, that vast numbers of citizens voting through early voting mechanisms sanctioned by law are stealing the elections. Some of his party members have even accepted that more people voting has normally been inimical to their chances of winning the position of the commander-in-chief. In our country, there have been three parallel sets arguments made in some segments of public discourse. One, that the universal voting rights should be withdrawn, with one set of voices claiming that they ought to be withdrawn on grounds of membership of particular socio-religious identities. And two, yet another set of voices claiming that the vast segments of populace should not even be granted a right to vote on the grounds that their alleged levels of productivity does not warrant their treatment as equal to the rich and those at the top of totem pole of socio-economic hierarchies. Yet another set of voices has begun to articulate the position that maybe public elections themselves may be unnecessary. One is tempted to claim, given the inordinate control that big business has over the executive and through it over the legislatures, that the substantive core of what we had hoped in terms of dispersal of social and political power to the one person, one vote system is no longer a reality. And this necessarily undermines one of the foundations of the concept of social justice. For political equality, as expressed through one vote and one co-equal voice, is to be the first step in protecting citizens and human beings from the depredations of the powerful. We were promised in the early years of this republic that the executive will have the moral obligation to implement the law and extend the protections for the citizens within the constraints imposed by the Constitution, not the least of which were to be the tenets of Article 14 and Article 21 against arbitrary action by the state. In the recent past, we repeatedly witnessed brazen abdication of responsibility in this regard, and that too with regard to sexual violence against women. In some instance, four youngsters from the lowered classes were picked up, allegedly on suspicion of raping and burning to death a young upper caste woman. Even before the preliminary investigation was concluded, they were taken to the alleged scene of the crime to ostensibly, quote unquote, reconstruct the crime scene, and were shot dead in an encounter with the police. Seemingly, the entire articulate section of the populace endorsed the action by the police. And it was widely accepted in public circles that the four youngsters from lowered classes were shot dead on a mere suspicion, that the encounter was in fact a fake one, and that in fact the police ought to be honored for such an action. Very disturbing. What was seemingly lost was the understanding as to why the law and particularly constitutional principles needs to restrain arbitrary action by the police. For once we grant normative sanction to arbitrary action, we also then inevitably make it possible that the police will then render its services in a manner that does not take into account the tenets of the rule of law and extraneous factors such as the convenience of the political class and or the benefits of an oligarchic class becomes the actuators and misuse of the force of the state. We had a situation not too long ago when one young woman had to threaten public suicide before the gates of the residence of a chief minister in order to have an FIR lodged on her complaint that she was raped by the local MLA. It is alleged that because the young woman had dared to complain, the police picked up her father and thrashed him so brutally that he died in custody. And now we hear of an even more gruesome incident of violence, a young Dalit woman who was brutalized in an unimaginable manner, allegedly complained of being raped by four young men of the dominant upper caste in the village. From the news reports, it seems that the police had failed to register the complaint properly and failed to investigate in a manner mandated by law for many days. The young lady was hospitalized and finally passed away due to her horrific injuries. What did the police then do? No, they did not hand over the body to the family. Instead, it is being alleged that the family of the victim was locked up and the body cremated by the police. The family, according to news reports, was barred for many days from meeting any journalist and or politician, their cell phones taken away, and this gets to be incredible. There are reports that the police had contemplated administering ethanol sodium to the members of the family of the victim. In a matter of involving the alleged rape and the killing of a young Dalit woman, due to the actions of four upper caste youngsters, her family was subjected to a narco test, and her declaration, seemingly of no consequence to the police. There were also reports that the state was allegedly planning to engage the services of a public relations firm. Surreal. Just surreal and horrifying, so much so that the Allahabad High Court had to ask the officials, who were all members of various upper castes, as to whether they would have behaved in the same manner had the victim been either their own daughter or from a family belonging to the upper classes. Let me hasten to add that this complete and total disregard of the law is not entirely new, nor is it exclusively in the provenance of this or that political party. It was not too long ago that the Supreme Court had to declare as unconstitutional the policy of the state arming young tribal men to the teeth, forming a vigilante force in aid of the coal mafia. However, what makes this even more alarming now is that the rulers and their aficionados seem to think that the image of the ruling party and that of its leaders is to be protected at any cost. Furthermore, they also seem to hold the position that the reputation of the party and its leaders is not independent on upholding the rule of law in protecting the fundamental rights of the citizens at the bottom of the socio-economic totem pole, but rather that it is dependent on their ability to project absolute power over the citizens and ensuring that the absence of any discourse that is contrary to the narrative they seek to present. Like any large corporation, the law is thus necessarily to be subordinate to the rule. When we embark in 1991 on the path of neoliberalization, late Sri Jaipal Reddy, a former union minister and known throughout his life for his honesty and indefatigable fight for democratic values, had famously warned the main protagonist, I quote, "Please be careful, lest the market begins to act as the state and the state begins to act as the market," unquote. It seems that what he warned us about has come to pass. Surreal, yes. But should it be shocking or even surprising to us? My reply would be a resounding no. How could it be shocking and unexpected when for nearly three decades now we have been guided by a philosophical and moral framework in which the dignity of the human being, if subservient to the basal calculus of the markets, when the directive principles of the state policy, the vital soul of the transformative constitution, have been elided even from effective discourse. When the very programmatic elements of the constitutional project that seeks to achieve the preambular promise of a fraternity with dignity and recognizes as a self-evident truth that unity and integrity of the nation is dependent on instantiation of social justice in all institutions of national importance, is effectively deemed to be relevant and even inimical to national purpose, at least by the tenets of the neoliberal polity that the elites and power holders seem to have subscribed to lock, stock and barrel. How could we have expected any different when the notion of dignity of human beings as an essential element of justice has been disregarded? The angst that many of us feel and the shock at the near demise of the rule of law, indeed the very notion of rule of law as being opposed to the arbitrary rule of man / regime, is well described by many committed Democrats. The many, many examples of violations of fundamental rights, a few of which I have broadly described as examples earlier, are testimony to the wider failures of the collective pacts of constitutional democracies. However, the mere expression of angst and limiting ourselves to a superficial analysis what went wrong in terms of political rights will not suffice. In fact, such analytical frameworks are fundamentally misguided and misled us into forgetting the very problems that Baba Saheb had warned us about in his speech to the Constituent Assembly when our constitution was ratified. More about it that a little later. Amartya Sen had a very presciently proposed in his book Argumentative India that the basic political freedoms were to be treated as essential elements of development, broadly conceived, and then went on to bemoan the fact that the practice of democracy had failed and had measurably underachieved on another set of parameters that those committed to a genuine social democracy ought to pursue: protection of the essential dignity of human beings by equipping them with the capacities to self-actualize, starting first with the removal of institutional and social hindrances to such a project. In the Indian context, that necessarily meant elimination of the depredations of endemic and graded inequalities in the socio-cultural, economic and political spheres that had normative support in institutional frameworks of governance and social control. That brings us to how our founding fathers visualized what the foundations of a true social democracy would be in the first instance. Let's be clear that a conception of balance as the sole outer limit of democracy was not countenanced, even if they did recognize that each electorally imposed change was a triumph of the belief in the small R revolution in order to prevent a big capital R revolution. If we use the distinction so presciently explained by Julius Stone in his book, The Province of Law, it was realized early on that the desire to tamp down the instincts for the big capital or revolution on the streets could not be premised on repetition of small or based changes of the power wielders through the operation of the ballot box. The changing of the government by ballots was thought of as a means to ensure that the new power wielders would be more zealous in pursuing the essential transformative goals of the constitution. the normative endpoints of the big capital or revolutions, they realized, could not be static utopias, but to be reimagined and reaffirmed in two facets of bedrock of equality. A, an indefeasible commitment to the right to the ballot box and participate in the public discourse. And B, an uncompromising commitment for the elimination of institutional and social blocks that hinder the building of capacities of self-actualization, the core of human dignity. People of India were to be valued as contributing members of the public discourse, individually and or by forming coalitions of groups that transcend traditional and limiting identities, so that a nation based on fraternity can be continuously imagined and built. It is often complained that the concept of democracy is alien to the societies of the East, and hence it is argued that the Eastern countries will never really be in a position to create and sustain genuine social democracies. One of the things that Amartya Sen talks about in his book, Idea of Justice, is that a greater appreciation of various proto-democratic experiments from the Buddhist councils during the heydays of Maurya Empire and elected councils of the city of Shushan, the southwestern Iran, to the Athenian democracy and the constitution of 17 articles that was enacted during the reign of Buddhist prince Shotoku in the 7th century is needed to understand that the instinct for democracy is not alien to Asia. Sen also points out that the philosophical framework of Asia had been able to take into account much earlier than in the West the understanding that even irreconcilable differences need not tear up societies as long as human empathy for each other and respect for each other's dignity are treated as primordial normative rules of all forms of social engagement. It would of course be particularly relevant to remember that one of 17 articles of Prince Shotoku emphatically asserted that, I quote, decisions on important matters should not be made by one person alone. They should be discussed by many, unquote. Another one proclaimed, I quote, nor let us be resentful when others differ from us. For all men have hearts, and each heart has its own leanings. Their right is our wrong, and our right is their wrong, unquote. And Baba Saheb, the great scholar that he is, made the definitive assertion that the philosophical moorings for establishment of a genuine social democratic society were far better understood in India, citing two Mahakavyas from Mandakopanishad, Aham Brahmasmi Tattvamasi, translated loosely by the great man as, I quote, as I see the universal principle in myself, and I recognize the same in you too, unquote. He emphatically grounded his arguments regarding the feasibility of a social democracy in India and such ancient wisdom. One of the abiding questions of theory of democracy and its practice has been about how, notwithstanding the fact that their right is our wrong and our right is their wrong, people could continue to respect each other without resentment. There are lessons from history that growth of acceptance of democratic practices was inextricably tied to levels of material and cultural inequality, and how the struggles for having a say in the protocols of governance and the consequent stability of the political order and of compacts for governance invariably turned violent when levels of inequality threatened the assumptions of what constituted a fair distribution of social products and also eliminated meaningful public participation by vast segments of populace. Some recent researchers have seemingly uncovered a historical fact. I'll quote this. For thousands of years, civilization did not lend itself to peaceful equalization. Across a wide range of societies and different levels of development, stability favored economic inequality. Consequently, violent shocks were of paramount importance in disrupting the established order, in compressing the distribution of income and wealth, in narrowing the gap between rich and the poor. Throughout the recorded history, the most powerful leveling invariably resulted from the most powerful shocks. Four different kinds of violent ruptures of flattened inequality: mass mobilization warfare, transformative revolution, state failure, and lethal pandemics, sometimes acting individually and sometimes in concert with one another. They produced outcomes that to contemporaries often seem nothing short of apocalyptic. Hundreds of millions perished in their wake, and by the time the dust had settled, the gap between the haves and the have-nots had shrunk, sometimes dramatically. This is from Walter Schiedel, Violence and the History of Inequality from the Stone Age to the 21st Century. An implied argument is often made. Both overtly and covertly, with regard to the above proposition, a cynical shriek by the elites that if that violent upheaval is what has to happen, then it will happen. And hence the misguided argument goes, we might as well get on with our present proclivities of uninhibited pursuit of individual welfare and enjoy it in our current disposition for ostentatious consumption. The problem with that argument is that the great and violent struggles, when they emerge, do not provide a timeline as to how long they last. Nor do they specify who will emerge as the real winners and losers. That is what history teaches us. Furthermore, history also teaches us that even from the perspective of those at the bottom, violent restructuring seldom results in a genuine social democracy. Instead, as Ted Hendry argues, in violence for equality, violence invariably lends itself to the enthronement of a new class of elites that many initially will not be rapacious, but will eventually get to be predated. And that cycle goes on. As we emerged from the detritus to the Second World, of the Second World War, and the 100 years of pillage and plunder of India, and Indians in a collaborative colonialism of British masters, supported and even underwritten by native elites, selling the interest of their fellow Indians down the river, the founding fathers visualized a democratic order that was to not only build a platform of public discourse, but a robust social order in which most, if not all, citizens are provided such capacities as to defend themselves against the possibility of epistemic injustice. In the context of policy formulation, implementation, and governance. Furthermore, they also recognized that as we are to foster violent upheavals caused by inequality, then the state as a forum of collective action was to be informed by certain principles that were to be fundamental to state action. prevent maldistribution of resources in a manner that is inimical to the welfare of all, and undertake such measures as will be needed to eliminate institutionally and socially imposed group and individual disabilities that prevent self-actualization, as well as limit the capacity of citizens to be fully empowered participants in public deliberation. The foregoing needs to be unpacked and briefly examined at a conceptual level of the historical processes that had led to the enslavement of India, which essentially meant a rapacious denuding of its vast numbers of people of all shades of humanity. A colonial regime built with the connivance of small proportion of elite communities did not just drain India of most of the social product created here. It lined the pockets and mansions of the few, as it made India's elite communities more outward looking on trade with the far distant parts of the British Empire. The local populace was seen more as part of the land to be exploited, an input at best with no moral standing of its own. This has impacted the life of vast majority of Indians in two ways. It intensified the dehumanization already in place in a caste-based feudal order that pre-existed the advent of the company rule, as every local norm of shared rights to produce and whatever minimal level that may have existed were eliminated, and the decline of whatever little syncretic impulses that had been generated under the dominant empires of pre-1700s. Most of India became merely a land for extraction of unconscionable rents for a few dominant regional satraps, local elites, and of course, the John Companies expropriating thugs. The macro level contours of horrendous damage inflicted on India during the period of colonial rule have been well described by various scholars. From how a people who were producing 28% of global output were reduced to the runt of the litter, how all its manufacturing capacity was destroyed, resulting in a reverse migration back to the villages, and over $40 trillion of value was siphoned off to Britain. All of that and plenty more has been well recorded. What is less reflected upon, and maybe even deliberately glossed over, is the fact that the rapine and plunder of India was made possible by elite segments of the population who were more than willing to form extractive and expropriating alliances with any ruler, foreign or domestic, as long as their rights of sharing in the spoils were preserved, and hence aided and abetted the plunder of India. This is an important aspect to keep in mind in order to understand why the directive principles of state policy were thought of as being necessary, especially those inter alia insisting that every institution of national importance be informed by values and practices of social justice, that the operation of the economy ought not to result in a distribution of material resources to the community in a manner that will derogate from public welfare, and the state shall take necessary steps to ensure that productive employment is available, that citizenry would have access to good quality education, and be provided with the skills necessary to be able to acquire, interact, and produce modern scientific knowledge. The history of behavior of the elites vis-a-vis the masses did not engender the kind of confidence that Gandhi's belief in a trusteeship role for the same elites took for granted. Baba Sahib wanted an explicit commitment as a textual marker that could aid the political discourse as to what the true national purpose was. That compact, most people would have to agree, is substantially in tatters well prior to reaching the substantive goals of social justice that we set for ourselves. We have again begun to extol the alleged achievements of the few, even if they be founded upon the plunder of India's resources and its authority. What was expected to be an evolutionary process of informing all walks of life, be informed by the principles of social justice that was made morally more urgent by making of directive principles of state policy foundational to making of law and policy. To forestall a revolutionary and hence violent equalization has now been turned on its head. The full-fledged adoption of the tenets of neoliberalism and the project of globalization has ensured that most are left with little and the few gain disproportionately of the social product. On a chilly wintry day in Delhi, after Jawaharlal Nehru read out his resolutions regarding aims and objectives, it was critiqued by Baba Sahib. I quote, "If this resolution has a reality behind it and a sincerity of which I have not the least doubt, coming as it does from the movers of the resolution, I should have expected some provisions whereby it would have been possible for the state to make economic, social, and political justice a reality. And I should have, from that point of view, expected the resolution to state in most explicit terms that in order that there may be social and economic justice in the country, that there would be nationalization of industry and a nationalization of land. I do not understand how it could be possible for any future government which believes in doing justice socially, economically, and politically, unless its economy is a socialist economy," unquote. While Baba Sahib eventually chose to frame the national purpose free of any nomenclature of a specific ism, and explicitly stated this was in order to be able to carry forward groups of people who differed widely, the fact remains that in his mind and the mind of other fathers of the nation, that the nation state was to be founded on two principles of an indefeasible recognition of human dignity, of all that could sustain a fraternal order, and in turn be sustained by a fraternity, so that the unity of the nation is assured. This was amply reflected by the warning sermon of Baba Sahib on the day that the constitution was ratified. It's worth citing him at length, but I would for the present leave a little bit and quote the operative portion. On the 26th of January 1950, we are going to enter into a life of contradictions. In politics, we will have equality, and in social and economic life, we will have inequality. In politics, we will be recognizing the principle of one man, one vote, and one vote, one value. In our social and economic life, we shall, by reason of our social and economic structure, continue to deny the principle of one man, one value. How long shall we continue to live this life of contradictions? How long shall we continue to deny equality in our social and economic life? If we continue to deny it for long, we will do so only by putting our political democracy in peril. We must remove this contradiction at the earliest possible moment, or else those who suffer from inequality will blow up the structures of political democracy, which this assembly has to laboriously build up as the many lakhs of daily wage earners, unquote. As the many lakhs of daily wage earners began their long, arduous and dangerous trek back to their villages, carrying their measly belonging on their heads, their feet being scorched on the hot tarmacs of our highways and byways, I was forced to utter again another set of words of Baba Saheb in the same speech. And I think they are worth repeating again. I quote, "But there can be no gainsaying that the political power in this country has too long been the monopoly of a few, and the many are only beasts of burden, but also beasts of prey. This monopoly has not merely deprived them of their chance of betterment, it has sapped them of what may be called the significance of life," unquote. Much has, of course, been written about the different eras of the Supreme Court, relating to how the directive principles of state policy were understood. I do not want to go into those well-known debates, except to point to the fact that Gautam Bhatia has presented a rather fine synopsis of the place of directive principles in the Constitution of India and the extant constitutional gloss. In particular, his articulation of the foundations laid by the Supreme Court in the Kerala Education Bill, that even as Article 37 sets for the non-enforceability condition, it also lays down the scope for use of directive principles in interpretative contexts, is sound. The use of directive principles in such instances is not tantamount to an enforcement, but actually an assumption that the legislature has acted reasonably in undertaking its responsibilities of a constitution that makes the principles enunciated in the directive principles of state policies foundational to making of law and policy. Bhatia also maps with great perspicacity the necessity of understanding of directive principles of state policy as markers of reasonableness and also as establishing a framework of values. I would at this stage not wish to engage in a lengthy analysis of all the three prongs of the roles that the Supreme Court has ascribed to the directive principles of state policy. There will not be enough time to do that. All the foregoing relate to whether the constitutional courts did the constitutionally permissible thing by using the directive principles in any manner or from whatsoever, howsoever slight, in adjudicating whether the positive affirmations in Part 3 relating to fundamental rights were significantly derogated from. The implicit assumption in the above is that it is the exclusive duty of the legislatures and the executives to act upon the imperatives etched in the directive principles and the constitutional codes do not have any role to play in finding an overlap between the values enshrined in the directive principles and the fundamental rights guaranteed in Part 3. But such a position would have been possible if and only if one had concluded that fundamental rights were themselves completely empty of positive content, the non-protection of which can lead to substantive derogation of the rights in Part 3 itself. The second essential condition would have to have been the legislatures and the executives be fully informed of the moral urgency of the problems of vast hordes reduced to living and dying in poverty, squalor, hunger, disease, and illiteracy, generation after generation. More often than not, the question that implicates values in the directive principles as a part of Part 3 rights arise before the constitutional courts when both the legislatures and the executives have significantly allowed the underperforming of the state with regard to making an effort at achieving the goals within the orbits of both Parts 3 and Part 4. For instance, where the Supreme Court of India asserted that the right to life cannot mean a mere animal existence, but that it encompasses the right to a life of dignity. What exactly were its critics saying, whether they intended to or not? Though couched in the language of constitutional text, particularly the term enforceable, and drawing stricter lines of demarcation between lawmaking and law interpretation, they failed to take into account the fact that the consequences of the failures of the legislatures and the executive in modulating the political economy in accordance with the directives in Part 4 and their implication in terms of non-realization of guarantees in Part 3 are horrendous, and not for just a handful of people here and there, but large swaths of populace. Indeed, one might even add a vast majority of the populace. The central concerns of the directive principles of state policy were of the kind to liberate the citizens of India from squalor, illiteracy, hunger, and powerlessness that had led to unconscionable levels of debasement of their humanity. Any number of cases can be cited when the Supreme Court and other constitutional courts in India have used the directive principles of state policy to read positive content into both rights guaranteed by Part 3, because no individual with a conscience could possibly have formed, under the circumstances of those particular cases, that lack of socio-economic and cultural rights were not limiting their ability to more fully enjoy the benefits of the rights guaranteed under Part 3. The alternate would have been that even the one forum in which issues of whether constitutional reality are to be decided on a case-by-case basis on principles of justice would not recognize the dehumanization they were subjected to, both by virtue of their material conditions as well as that being further intensified by the state being indifferent even to the point of refusal to articulate the moral unease mandated by the Constitution. While deontological foundations of the ethics of social action against debilitating inequalities and socio-economic deprivations themselves ought to be sufficient justification for declaratory judgments and directions by the constitutional courts, the consequentialist logic is no less persuasive. there is considerable amount of literature and discussions about how extreme forms of deprivation are counterproductive in terms of both the larger issues of economic growth and development of the country, and also severely limiting in terms of realization of full potential by individuals to such deprivation. The time allowed for this lecture would not be sufficient to go into all those matters. However, there is another consequentialist view that must be taken into account, and it is often not significantly recognized or discussed. And that relates to the issues of stability of the nation state and the possibility of the constitutional project itself being derailed when societies are marked by extreme inequalities of wealth, economic opportunity, and institutionalized inhibition of access to socio-political capital for a dignified life. As I sit at my desk and dictate this lecture, I hear that people of Chile have voted in an overwhelming majority, 78%, in favor of changes to the constitution to make the state commit to eliminate unconscionable levels of inequality and to make education, healthcare, and core infrastructural facilities part of the obligations of the state to provide. The referendum was held because of the massive protest of the people of Chile, particularly the youngsters, in November 2019, raising fears of large-scale massacres by armed forces. Fortunately, public pressure seems to have prevailed in allowing the people to express their views and has created the potential to change the constitution to reflect the core desires of the people of Chile. What makes this remarkable is that by no metric could be considered Chile to be an underdeveloped or even a developing economy. And yet the maldistribution of economic pie that results from social action based on the aggressive neoliberal policy of prescriptions of the Chicago Boys has provoked massive levels of angst. It's fortunate, of course, that the capital R of revolution was transmuted into the less bold, albeit still a capital R style of constitutional revolution. It's of course but a first step, and we have to wait and see whether there is a greater accommodation of the wishes of the people expressed in such unequivocal terms. The social movements and the political revolution in Chile is of course not the only indication of a great churning. We have had many visuals over the past three decades of those who are left behind and not given a fair share of the social produce, and feel that the gravity train is leaving them by taking to many. Gravy train is leaving them to make by taking to many forms of anti-democratic and even bloody means of revolution, to use Babasaheb's expression. Almost no country has remained immune. The response of the neoliberal ideology and the political economy of massive benefits for the few and very little for the many has been to inflict a form of epistemic injustice, of treating the anxieties and angst of those being left behind as not worthy of consideration in the legislative halls, in the clubby offices of the political executives, in the boardrooms of corporate executives who buy out law and policy, and even finally in the media. to the point that those being left out begin to feel that the nation state is not theirs anymore. Or at least that the institutions of democratic governance are not legitimate. Neoliberal globalized political economy has created a thin veneer of global elites whose preoccupations with the trivial suggest a clear break between their worlds and the worlds of the vast majority. Nation states were products of a movement of self-identification of a group or groups of people as belonging to a common nation with a shared compact of joint purposes. While initially they were premised upon narrow ethnic considerations and of an us versus them struggle for resources and survival, it was realized that for nation states to exist in peace with each other and also remain stable and prevent violence within, they were to be premised on the conclaves of inclusion based on empathy for the human condition. However, as Emmanuel Castells points out in his 3-volume tome, Network Society, the socioeconomic conditions that arise as a result of increasing levels of inequality that accompany neoliberal globalization, its consequent precariousness of life's prospects, and a sense of abandonment by the nation itself potentially creates fertile grounds for social unrest. The consequent search for identity is likely to push the masses into choosing divisive platforms of hatred for others who are then promoted as the ones who have misappropriated their chances and have created their anxieties. Partisanship is likely to reign supreme, the prospects of a common platform dim or non-existent, as at the root of the political economy that we allowed to be inscribed was not based on principles of social justice, empathy and inclusion, but was structured as a zero-sum game. The above necessarily implies that politics is no longer the civilized discourse based on core democratic principles. Nor let us be resentful when others differ from us. In a neoliberal worldview, in which only greed and self-interest are the legitimate guides to normatively valid social action, politics is viewed only as a zero-sum game that pits neighbor against neighbor. Are we now hearing the sounds of the death struggle of the idea of a liberal constitutional democracy? I will leave that to you, listeners, to decide whether we are at least hearing the early warnings of that possibility. Even if we were to assume that death of democracy is way too strong an expression and offends our delicate dispositions, surely we ought to be worried about whether the platform for public discourse and democratic decision making can extract the commitment to the rule of law when collective action requires considerable sacrifice of the individual self-interest. We are likely to face many, many more vital questions implicating the need to commit to collective action. In a sense, the ongoing global pandemic COVID-19, horrifying as it is in terms of the consequences to its victims and the economic mayhem it has unleashed, is probably likely to be a small blip compared to the monstrous problems we are likely to face in the future. We will need to depend more on our empathetic core and our potential instinct for mutual recognition of indefeasible human dignity of each other. Surely, the horrifying images of the daily wage earners walking 1,000 plus kilometers in a hot summer with their meager belongings should at least make us pause to think about whether we are being compelled to abandon the possibility of building a society based on empathy for the human condition. Let me end this lecture here. But before I take leave, I need to say a few words that affirm the possibility of greater sanity in human interactions. There are many, many reasons for our society to be independently thankful to Vasantha Kannabiran. Her own individual contributions have been no less than that of the man in whose memory these lectures are being organized. What a remarkable couple. What they gave so much of themselves to make the society better for others. In addition to thanks, I must express for all that, I must of course thank you, Srimati Vasantha Kannabiran, for giving me this opportunity to speak on this occasion. I truly feel humbled. I must also thank Dr. Kalpana Kannabiran and other members of the family for organizing these lectures. They are much needed, and it will always be my privilege to be associated with any such activities in memory of your father, Kalpana, Senior Advocate K.G. Kannabiran. Thank you. Thank you very much. Long live the Constitution of India. Jai Hind.